Retirement System's 70th annual conference here at the Grand Traverse Resort. On October 16th, 1947, MERS' first annual meeting was held at the Hotel Olds in Lansing. 50 delegates were in attendance, and Gerald Mead, chairman of the board at that time, presided over the meeting. He stated that the meeting was being held for the purpose of selecting nominees for membership on the retirement board and for the transaction of such other business as may be required for the proper operation of the retirement system. 70 years later, we continue to come together each year to accomplish those very same objectives, and the MERS system continues to grow and strengthen, something that we should celebrate and certainly be proud of. As I look out in the audience, there are certainly more than 50 of us in attendance, and it's been told, I don't know the exact number, that this might be a record attendance this year. So thank you and congratulations to everybody that attends. We certainly appreciate you being here. Yesterday you had the opportunity to listen to as MERS CEO Chris DeRose walked us through a history of retirement. I see that the time machine has been removed, so there's no worry that I need to change outfits. I'm glad, certainly glad of that. Although I don't know about you, I was certainly fascinated with the facts and impressed by his fashion. I do have to go off script for just a minute and comment. I was talking with some folks at the dinner last night, and I commented that when Chris came out in the 80s, that's sort of my era with the shirt. I said, I think it should have been the members only jacket. Yeah, there you go. And I'm sure each one of you saw the outfits and said, well, wait a minute. But I chuckle. It seemed like all of us had one of those. So, Chris, thank you for the entertainment, if nothing else. What struck me most, though, is realization of how much the retirement landscape has changed, even in just the last few decades. The landscape continues to change as the average lifespan increases, retirement age decreases, and we look for ways to stabilize the funding of our pension obligations. Today we have three presentations that will help us better understand how these changes are affecting our retirement reality. And in just a few minutes, Chris, our CEO, will provide us with an update on the state of MERS. Our Chief Investment Officer, Jeb Burns, will update us, pardon me, on insight into the state of MERS investments, and then our actuary consultant, Jim Koss, will present an actuarial update. But before we get to that, if you're able, would you please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much. Again, as I said, my name is Michael Brown. I'm the chair of the MERS Retirement Board. I've had the privilege of serving as the officer member on the board since November of 2007. I'm the county administrator for Barry County, where I've served since 1995 and have been a member of the MERS system for over 20 years now. I'd like to take a minute to introduce fellow board members, and if you'd just stand as I introduce your name, Mr. Dale Felposh. Dale is chief financial officer for the Capital Region Airport Authority and has served as an officer member since January of 2016. Randy Gerard. Randy is township manager for the Charter Township of Marquette and has served as an officer member of the board, like me, since November of 2007. Ms. Amy DeFord. Amy is the retirement administrator for Saginaw County and has served as an employee member of the board since January of 2012. Mr. Jason Serrata. Jason is a firefighter and paramedic for Delta Township and has served as an employee member of the board since January of 2016. Ms. Sally Dreves. Sally is an employee of the Department of Public Works for Grand Traverse County and has been an employee member of the board since 2004. Mr. Jim Wiersma. Jim is one of two appointed public professional members on the board. He's the president of Family Investment and Resource Management, the family office of the Hayworth family in Holland, and has been a board member since March 2009. Mr. Michael Gilmore. Michael is the other appointed public professional member of the MERS board. He's director of investment strategies for Delta Dental and Okemos and has been a member of the board since 2012. And I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge you. It's my understanding he was just promoted to vice president as opposed to director. So congratulations on the promotion, Michael. And then Mr. John Ogden. John is our retiree member of the board, retired in December of 2012 from the city of Port Huron. He's the former director of finance, a CPA, and has served on the MERS board since 2003. Also present at our monthly meetings and seated along with the board is Mr. Chris DeRose, our CEO, and Ms. Pamela Steffi, our board secretary. I'd like to personally thank everybody for your service, and if we could give the staff and board a round of applause. Thank you. The purpose of this part of the annual meeting is to conduct the business meeting, of the annual conference. And as chair of the retirement board, I would like to call the 70th annual business meeting of Municipal Employees Retirement System to order. In your conference booklet and on the app, and I was told, are there gonna be instructions on the screen? Perfect. You'll find the minutes along with on the screen directions to get to the minutes from last year's meeting. Shortly, I'm gonna ask for a motion if I could get someone to stand and find one of the microphones, make a motion, and someone else to second that. That would be wonderful. And if you'd indicate your name and the municipality that you represent for an accurate record, we'd greatly appreciate it. So if everybody's had an opportunity to find the minutes at this time, would a delegate like to make a motion to approve the 2015 annual business meeting minutes of the Municipal Employees Retirement System?
So moved. Ron McRae from the city of Harper Springs.
Ron, thank you for that motion. Pam, did you get that okay? Wonderful. Someone like to second that?
Second that.
Thank you, Vivian. Pam, you've got that all as well? Wonderful. So we have a motion and a second to adopt the 2015 annual business meeting minutes. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed? Wonderful. Motion carries. Thank you. Is there any old business that a certified delegate would like to bring before the members? If there is any old business that anyone would like to bring forward, if you'd step to the microphone as well. Hearing none. Is there any new business that a delegate would like to bring before the members? All right. Any new business? Hearing none, I would call on John Ogden to join us. Please explain the board nomination and election process. Candidate profiles are located in the business meeting section of the conference booklet, as well as the candidate profile section of the conference app. Thank you, John.
Michael. Good morning. Each year at the annual MERS business meeting, an election is held to elect individual members to serve on the MERS retirement board. The MERS plan document requires that the system hold an annual meeting to elect the retirement board members and to conduct other business. We just conducted the other business. Now is the time for this year's election. The election will be for two positions, one officer board member and one employee board member. Each person is elected to serve a three-year term. Voting is open to all employee and employer delegates. A red dot on your name tag identifies you as a voting delegate. So if your name tag looks like mine, you're not a voting delegate. If you have a red dot, then you are. Each voting delegate can vote for all open board positions. So for this year, each delegate can vote for one officer position and one employee position. Before we start, I want to give you a brief overview of the election process. Candidates can declare themselves prior to an established deadline before the annual meeting, and there also can be nominations from the floor. Once nominations are closed, candidates will have the opportunity to introduce themselves to the membership. Voting will take place after all candidates have had a chance to speak to you. As previously stated, only delegates can vote, and whether you are an employee or an employer delegate, you can vote for both offices. Volunteer tellers will count the ballots in a separate room. And for this year, our volunteer tellers are Ed Brennan from the city of Port Huron, Cindy Prue from the city of Adrian, Dave Sabuda from the city of Flint, and David Keenan from the city of Midland. It's now time to open nominations for the employee delegate. We have one declared candidate, Tina Butler of Cass County. Are there any nominations from the floor? I have this light in my eyes. If there are no nominations, can I have a motion to close the nominations? Thank you. Could I have your name and community, please?
Karen Folks, Cass
County. Karen Folks, Cass County. Do we have a second? Thank you. And Pam, did you get that? John Weber, Lakeview Cemetery. So the nominations for the employee delegate are now closed. We also need to open nominations for the employer delegate. We have one declared candidate, Michael Brown from Barry County. Are there any nominations from the floor? If there are no nominations, can I have a motion to close the nominations? Pam, did you get that? Thank you, because I couldn't repeat the name. The Cindy Peterson I got, but so thank you. Is there a second?
I second.
Thank you. Okay, now we are going to allow the candidates time to address the membership. Even though we do not have a contested election for either position, this will give each candidate the opportunity to tell you about themselves. So first, the employee candidate, Tina Butler of Cass County. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good luck.
Good morning. I have been proud to serve Cass County for the past 28 years, and I've been privileged to be a member of MERS for 26. As with many municipalities, our workforce is both union and non-union. I've been a long-standing member of an independent union for 26 years, and I have served as its president since 2011. In my role as president, I am the chief negotiator of five different contracts with six separate employers. What I've learned in that process is that educating yourself about your retirement benefit is not merely a need, but it is an absolute necessity. I've made it a point to be a student of our defined benefit plan, as well as educating myself on other public retirement options so that I can better represent not only the needs of my membership, but for the benefit of all employees in our municipality. Understanding your benefits may not be because of what you have to gain, but it may be because of what you have to lose. That being said, I think most of us would agree that times are really pretty challenging right now for retirement plans, not just in Michigan, but also nationwide. I fully understand that the fiduciary responsibility of the MERS board is so important, more than ever, and I applaud MERS for not only recognizing those demands, but for taking a proactive approach in developing sustainable solutions. I firmly and sincerely believe in the expertise of MERS, of its personnel, and in the integrity of its plans. As an employee board member, I would continue to share that confidence to inspire new employees and to motivate existing ones to be an active participant in their financial futures. I would be very honored to be your employee voice. Thank you.
Thank you, Tina. Now we'll hear from the employer candidate, Michael Brown from Berry County.
Good morning.
Thank you, John. It's been a great talking with many of you during the conference, sharing your thoughts, ideas, concerns, and dreams, having the opportunity to learn just a little bit about you. Hopefully you've had an opportunity to learn a little bit about me. Of course, my name is Michael Brown. And as I go through script, you're gonna, I think, hear that at least one more time. I'm a member of MERS for nearly 24 years now. Hard to believe as I think about that. I'm a county administrator for what I consider to be the best county in the state of Michigan, Berry County, a position I've held for 21 years now. A graduate of Michigan State University. I've served on the MERS board since 2007 and the board chair since 2013. I'm also blessed with a wonderful family. My wife Jackie and I have been married for 21 years now. We have a son, Tyler, who is 16, and a daughter, Shannon, that is 14. My experience on the board with a career as a county administrator, I think, has provided a firsthand understanding of the pressures that we currently face at MERS. A need for more affordable plans, continued political and regulatory pressures, increasing unfunded liabilities, and of course, an environment of low interest rates. During my time as chair, my focus has been on balancing our duty to participants with being sensitive to the difficult financial situation many local units face right now. MERS has changed its product and I believe works very hard to partner to find solutions. And I think that's a key term to me, is partnership. During my time on the board, which effectively began with the meltdown or crash, if you may, in 2008, MERS has steadily and consistently improved its service to municipalities, lowered its costs, listened to your concerns, and worked to become a true partner. And even during very difficult financial times, more than 50 new municipalities have chosen to join MERS. Most recently, MERS created an opportunity for financially stressed municipalities to extend their payment schedule. While this won't apply to many, for some it will be critically important. Just another example that the MERS board and MERS is listening. I hope that you'll support my continued candidacy for the position on the board, and I want it so that I can help ensure that MERS is around for another 70 years. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Because neither position is contested, at this time I'd like to ask for a motion to declare an anonymous ballot for both the employee and the employer positions, and declare Tina Butler and Michael Brown the elected employee and employer board members, respectively. So could I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Thank you, Ron. And do we have a second? Thank you. All those in favor of the motion, please respond by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, nay. I think the ayes have it. Thank you. And that will conclude the election.
Thank you, John, and congratulations, Tina. Thank you, everybody, for your continued support of the board, and most importantly, for your willingness to contribute your thoughts and comments. I've greatly enjoyed listening to them. I know Tina and the rest of the board members have as well. It's important. It's an opportunity that we get to hear firsthand from each of you, so thank you. It's my pleasure now to invite Chris DeRose to the stage to present the State of the MERS report.
Good morning, everyone. For the last 3 years, ending this year, we've been working, the board and our awesome staff have been working on a strategic plan that's about to come to an end. I think what we can say about that, because we have good evidence, good data, is that we have improved customer satisfaction. It's not perfect, but it's improved over the last 3 years. We've lowered our costs. We've grown considerably, and many of you believe that we've become a true partner. The question we asked ourselves as we built a strategic plan for the next 4 years until 2020 was, can we do even better? And the answer that we came up with was that we must do better. And this is the vision for the next 4 years. We're going to deliver superior value by first a deeper understanding, which is a more complete understanding than we even have now of what your needs are, and then directly connecting with you on that and trying to meet those needs. Consistently delivering services through intuitive processes. We're not always consistent, and we know that. And we're going to get consistent, more consistent. And we're going to make those processes that you interact with more intuitive, easier for you to work with. We're going to proactively partner with those of you who are working with us as employers by providing new options and information that will help meet the unique needs of your situation. And from a participant perspective, we're going to significantly increase the resources and the awareness that will help participants improve their financial wellness and be ready for retirement. So that's where we're headed. But let's get back to basics. What's our mission? It's important to understand the role that we have created to play, that we were created to play in administering your plans. MERS is an independent professional retirement services company that was created to administer the retirement plans for Michigan's municipalities on a not-for-profit basis. Well, I don't know the specifics of the Wells Fargo situation that's been in the paper most recently. I can tell you that there's something special about being a not-for-profit that allows us to keep you always at the forefront of our minds. Our elected board is responsible for the administration of the system and has fiduciary responsibility for the investment of the assets and the oversight. MERS provides employers with peace of mind that comes with knowing that we take on that sole fiduciary responsibility for your plan. As such, MERS assumes the liability for the core functions of the plan, including establishing the plan document, selection of the investment options, monitoring fund performance, and ensuring that fees are reasonable. We think that this approach is working because we now have 84% of Michigan's municipalities as members of MERS, 17 new municipalities just since I spoke with you last year. From our humble beginnings in 1945, with four municipalities in the defined benefit program, we now have all of these offerings. The world has evolved, as I talked about yesterday, and we've evolved with it. What we know is that much of the growth that we have experienced has been because municipalities and participants appreciate the one-stop shopping aspect of MERS. They put their employees in these plans and trust us to handle them. As a participant, you can call or email or use your individual account and get the answers that you need related to whatever program you're in. If you'll allow me just for a minute to go around the wheel, I think it's important because not all of you have all of these products, but I do think it's important that you understand that we have all of them. At the top of the wheel, you know, the vast majority of our customers, as you'll see in my next slide, have the defined benefit plan. More and more are in the defined contribution plan. We have a hybrid, a combination of those two. We offer a 457 supplemental savings plan. We have a very popular health care savings plan as folks try to deal with their OPEB liabilities. The next two slices speak to the fact that we will invest your money, your OPEB liability or your OPEB trust monies for you. Or if you want to administer your own pension benefits, you're outside MERS right now and you want to administer them, but you want us to do the investment, we'll do that for you. We also have a Medicare Advantage program, group life and disability programs. At a high level, you can see that 66% are in the defined benefit, 26% in the defined contribution, and 8% in the hybrid plan. We all understand that benefits are determined at the local level. You all make these decisions. MERS is able to manage this increasingly diverse set of options. Today, our customers' product selections are more diverse than ever, with the majority still offering DB, but there is a strong and growing trend toward defined contribution and hybrid plans. No matter what plan you are in, we are committed to providing you superior value, low cost, which we define as low cost and great service. Our mission is to help you get ready for retirement if you are a participant. Let me just quickly talk to you about the distribution of funding in the defined benefit plans. If you look at the top of this slide, you'll see that there are 54% that are more than 100% funded. And if you look at the bottom, you can see that there are 48 that are less than 50% funded. As a reminder, each municipality's retirement plan is maintained in a separate trust, which gives our members the benefits of pooling from an investment perspective while maintaining the integrity and the individuality of your plan. So let's talk about what it takes, what adequate funding means. Pension plans should have a strategy in place to reach 100% funded level or greater over a reasonable time frame. It's important to understand that a pension plan's funding progress should not be reduced to a single point in time. We're looking for the trend. We're looking for the movement toward 100%. Since across the state, each municipality, MERS and non-MERS, determines benefits and sets assumptions at the local level, it's misleading to compare average funding levels. We use consistent assumptions at MERS, but there are, you know, many plans that are across the state, home rule plans, that aren't in MERS, and they're using differing assumptions. MERS has a successful track record of improving the financial health of our members' plans. So let's talk about how we do this. Every 5 years, we do a comprehensive analysis. We call it the experience study. What have we experienced in the last 5 years? It compares the predictions that we made to what actually happened during the last 5 years, and it adjusts the assumptions that we use accordingly. This is part of MERS fiduciary responsibility. It's conducted, the experience study is conducted with our actuarial firm, and you're going to hear from Jim Koss in just a moment, every 5 years. And as I said, it compares the actual experience of the plan with the current assumptions to determine if changes are necessary, and then we adjust incrementally every 5 years. We spent a lot of time on this at our last annual conference, so let me just briefly remind you of the changes. The assumed rate of investment return net of all expenses was reduced from 8 to 7.75. The mortality table was adjusted to reflect that people are living longer, and the amortization period was moved to a fixed period for the 2014 annual valuations. Briefly, on the investment assumption, the investment return assumption determines the portion of the benefits that are assumed to be provided by the investment income. When developing the economic assumptions such as this, we take into consideration the long-term perspective because retirement plans operate over long-term time horizons. It's important to focus on the long-term rates rather than a single year. Simply put, someone starting in an open defined benefit plan today could easily work 30 years, perhaps more, and then be retired for 30 or more and be leaving part of that benefit to a beneficiary or a spouse. So we really are thinking about 60, 70, 80 year time frames for these investments. While recent history, we have to consider whether recent history has fundamentally changed the future economic outlook. We have to take into consideration analysis and forecasts from experts and government sources. And we have to do an evaluation of the economic assumptions against comparable public retirement systems. There's been a downward trend in the long-term expected rates of return. According to the recent public fund survey of the National Association of State Retirement Administrators, which reviewed 127 plans across the nation, more than half have reduced their investment return assumptions since the fiscal year 2008. The average investment return assumption at the end of 2015 was 7.62%. So what's the impact to MERS? Historically, we've met the 8% investment return assumption over the long term. In fact, our 35-year rate of return is 9.43%. Since the financial crisis of 2008, the consensus of the public plan investment community is that 8% return assumption may be too high. We do think at MERS that it is too soon to conclude that the recent economic conditions permanently, let me emphasize permanently, have changed the future long-term financial markets. We may make that conclusion in a future experience study, but we have not made that conclusion yet. MERS has determined that it would be prudent to reduce our long-term investment assumption to 7.75, and this change increases the likelihood that MERS will meet or exceed that assumption. On the mortality table, as with all of our assumptions, the mortality assumption is based, is reviewed every 5 years. The previous two experience studies actually showed that people were living shorter lifetimes. The most recent, the one we did last year, shows that MERS retirees are now experiencing longer lifetimes. There has been sufficient increase in longevity of retirees to warrant the use of a new mortality table that projects longer lifetimes. And we built in a little extra cushion on that for the idea that over the next 5 years, the longevity will continue to improve. As your plan fiduciary, our primary goal is to ensure that you have adequate assets to pay those retirement benefits as people retire. MERS has addressed unfunded accrued liability in a number of ways over the past decade, including policy decisions that expand product offerings, giving you options to lower your costs and your unfunded liability, and to assist you with ways that can manage that unfunded liability. Let's talk first about the amortization policy. So one important aspect of any funding policy, how we fund these benefits, is the amortization policy. The amortization policy sets the process for making payments on the fund's unfunded accrued liability. To oversimplify it, how many years are you going to need to pay on any unfunded liability? This policy doesn't make the benefits cheaper or more expensive. It simply impacts the pattern of paying for those benefits. Historically, public pension plans like MERS have used what's called a rolling amortization, I'll go into that in a moment, for a period of 30 years, and they focused on trying to keep the contributions to your municipality stable so that you can budget for them over time. It's important to highlight some of the other things we've done, what we call our fiscal responsibility policies that support the overall funded policy. MERS was ahead of the curve by requiring an actuarial report before benefit enhancements. So before a municipality can improve benefits, we required a study so that you knew exactly what the impact of that would be. That's now become state law and is required. Minimum funding requirements were first at 60%, later increased to 80% and are now at 100%. So you need to be at 100% funded with MERS before you can increase or improve benefits, or else you have to pay for those all up front. We also have the 3x minimum funding policy, which essentially means that you have to have three times your annual retirement payroll in your fund, or we're going to require that you actually put that amount of money in to safeguard. That's a policy safeguard that prevents plans from running out of assets to pay the benefits that have been promised. So let's talk about fixed amortization. In an effort to be proactive on the accounting changes, Governmental Accounting Standard Board 68 changes, as well as in support of adequacy — adequacy is another way of saying making sure you have enough money to make the pension payments — and intergenerational equity, another way of saying let's pay for the benefits, let's fully fund the benefits before the person retires, so all the money is there for that person. In 2014, MERS moved to a fixed amortization policy. This means that rather than rolling the liability forward when it hits 20 years, there will be a fixed number of years to pay it off, bringing your funding, your plan to full funding. So prior to this, as we went down a year at a time, 30, 29, 28, 27, when we got to 20, we refinanced that. We rolled it forward and refinanced it again for another 20 years. And that's the essence of the big change. Now we're going to continue to go down a year at a time so that you actually pay off that unfunded accrued liability. For new unfunded accrued liability, so unfunded accrued liability that occurs sometime in the future, if you're in an open plan, we will be amortizing that for 15 years. That doesn't start until we get to 15 years. We're at 23 and we'll go 22, 21, all the way down to 15. After that, when new unfunded accrued liability occurs, it'll be financed over 15 years. For closed plans, because once you have a closed plan, no new entrants into it, then that has to have a shorter amortization. That period will be 10 years. We understand this is a fundamental shift in policy that gives plans a specific date by which they will know when their plan is fully funded. It's important to note that this change in and of itself doesn't create more cost. It just means that the unfunded accrued liability is, if it is created in the future, that it'll be paid off in a set number of years. It ensures that you are making that appropriate progress toward full funding. MERS has also implemented a number of enhancements to help you move forward in your long-term planning for full funding and for retirement readiness. We've added budget projection scenarios to the annual valuations to assist with long-term planning. I'd really encourage you to read your annual valuation. I can't remember which page it's on, but relatively early in there, we have projections that show that, for instance, if we don't make our long-term investment assumption of 7.75, this is what it'll do to your contributions. And if you say, I'd like to be more conservative, I don't think that MERS is going to make 7.75 in the future, it gives you the amount of money that you can put into your fund if that's what you want to do. We've made significant strides to reduce and stabilize our administrative costs. While these are a small part of the overall costs you pay, They are an important cost, and we've reduced them by 31% over the last 5 years. We've developed new plan design options that in many of the sessions that you've attended today we've talked about, or you've talked to some of our regional teams about things that you can do. And we've provided retirement readiness snapshot reports now for the second year. We all need people who will give us feedback. That's how we improve. I personally, but our teams have been all over the state, and we continue to go all over the state listening to employees and employers and taking your feedback as we work on new options. We understand that change is ongoing and that we need to meet your needs. So we understand that costs are a concern. I spent a little bit of time yesterday talking about that. Increasing cost to your plan, driven by the adjustments to the longer life expectancies that I just talked about, and the volatile investment markets are a key concern for some of you, and your ability to balance your budgets under a time of significant fiscal stress, lower revenues coming in, and maintain key essential services. That's what some of you are really struggling with. I guess I would say all of you, some more than others. Let me say that. So we are providing a new option that was announced about a week or so ago. It's important to remember, and here is the option. While the amortization policy changes are not a driver in increasing your costs, as we've gone around the state, we've heard that they are a major concern for some. While our current policies are in alignment with our funding goals, that is, getting you to full funding, some customers need flexibility with the time frame in which we are getting them to full funding. They need more years. So we're offering a one-time extension of the amortization periods for open and closed plans. And since all plans have unique funded levels and demographics, approval would be provided by MERS following what we call a sustainability analysis, which is a fancy way to say that our actuaries are going to look at it a number of different ways to make sure that it would be a prudent step to allow you to extend that. It's important, we think, to remember that by extending the amortization period, assuming it is approved, you're deferring some costs into the future, and that you do that with eyes wide open. And that will actually result in higher costs over the long term. But if you believe that your municipality would be interested in reviewing this option, contact your regional manager, and we're working on the process whereby you can apply and we can get you through the analysis. The board has also listened to your feedback regarding the minimum funding requirement for closing a defined benefit and moving to a defined contribution system. Moving forward, there will be no minimum funding requirement in your defined benefit plan. Rather, we'll do this sustainability analysis that will indicate the appropriate amortization period that's needed, and then what your contribution requirements will be. You can look at that report and decide, given that, whether you want to make that decision or not. In the past, some municipalities have perceived this funding threshold as a barrier to moving to defined contribution, and if that was their choice. This lets the decision be made by the local unit, but it also says that MERS will give you a projection of the impact and so in advance of the decision so that you will be informed of the impact on your contributions. So let's talk about funding at the macro level. Just as a reminder, by state law, plans are required to be pre-funded, which really means 100% funded. Every single MERS municipality has made their required contributions. Often, even though they don't say it explicitly in the press, there's this impression that somehow people aren't making their contributions, and everyone is in MERS. In our 70-year history, we have never missed a pension payment to retirees. Again, with all that's being said in the public domain about this, I think that's an important point. That's really my lead into pension reform. You may have recently seen media attention and rhetoric around the state on local pension plans. I want to take a moment while we're all together to review that issue with you. Understanding pensions and how they are funded can be complicated, and we want to make sure that we share accurate information. So we've kind of tried to provide this as, here's the myth, here's what people are saying, and here's the fact. First myth, underfunding in the MERS system is caused by overly generous assumptions about future investment returns and mortality rates. I think the fact is that underfunding occurs for a number of reasons, including historical benefit enhancements and the once in 100-year market downturn in 2008. As a voluntary system, and as our core competency, we take in systems, many have joined, that were underfunded. And then we help assist getting them toward 100% funding. That's why we were created, that's what we do. To ensure assumptions are sound, we perform an experience study every 5 years. And even in years where we don't make, for instance, our investment assumption, we begin an incremental process of increasing your contributions to make up for that. It's an important fact that many policymakers either don't understand or don't talk about. Second myth is that MERS investments have dismal performance. Our chief investment officer will be talking to you in a fair amount more detail in a moment, or in a few moments, about our investment program and our investment performance. But the fact is that as MERS plans operate over the long-term horizons, as I've talked about, it's important to focus on the long-term investment rates rather than any one specific year. MERS consistently outperforms its benchmarks, market averages, and the magic, if you will, of defined benefit plans is that these investment returns pay for about half of the payments that actually go out, meaning that the contributions don't have to come from the employees or the employers. You'll hear more about the investments shortly. The next myth is that there's less accountability and responsibility is more dispersed and less direct with MERS compared to an entity that manages its own pension system. The fact is that MERS follows industry standards for transparency, accountability, and fiduciary responsibility. We take great pride in that, and it sometimes leads to some awkward conversations when we ask you to do things or we ask you to put in additional contributions when it's our fiduciary duty, and it leads to conflict around financing these benefits. But that's what we do, and I think we do it well. We are governed by an elected board that doesn't receive compensation. And as planned fiduciary, we put our members first, making sure that there's sufficient funds there to make sure the payments are made. This is what we were created to do. I think it's something we do well. The next myth is that closing all pension plans and mandating everyone into a 401k would create savings for taxpayers. Closing a plan doesn't reduce costs or unfunded liability. If all plans in MERS were to be closed, the investment return assumption, the investment allocation, would need to be recalibrated, which means it would need to be lowered at some point, to ensure that adequate cash is on time to pay the remaining retirees. This likely means that there would be higher contributions that would be needed, at least in the short run, and the short run is many years, 10 or 20 years, to address this lower funding or this lower investment return assumption. To be clear, in certain situations, depending on how the benefits are structured, it could in the long run be cheaper for a municipality. So I'm not arguing the case for defined contribution versus defined benefit. I am making clear to policymakers that in the short run, it is likely going to cost more for municipalities to pay off these unfunded accrued liabilities. Next myth is if the state doesn't fix the pension crisis, all municipalities will go bankrupt. Recent studies by the University of Michigan Close-Up Program and the Michigan Citizens Council show that the state's municipal finance system is one of the key underlying issues affecting local services. So while some would like to say that it's pensions that are causing all of the problems, I think you at least have to acknowledge that the way we are financing local government in Michigan has something to do with those difficult decisions. The graphic here just shows that it's important to look at the data. This is all of the pension systems in local pension systems in Michigan based on data from Michigan State University. You can see that 60% of the liability comes from 859 plans. So it's, you know, dispersed over all these plans, but that 40%, a substantial amount of the pension liability, is in 10 plans. And that's why I continue to encourage policymakers to take a tactical rather than a global approach to this problem, because I think we can isolate it down to a smaller number of municipalities rather than a one-size-fits-all solution. As a reminder of a previous slide that I showed you, some of, in MERS anyway, are more than 100% funded. And the average is probably about 70%. The other thing that I think it's important to recognize, and most of you know this, is that OPEB liabilities, retiree health care liabilities, are actually a much larger problem in terms of the size of the liability, primarily because we haven't had a requirement to pre-fund those liabilities. The next myth is that local municipalities aren't sophisticated enough to manage their retirement benefits. Well, in the last 5 years, 73% of you within MERS have taken proactive steps to manage their benefit commitments by lowering their costs and closing their funding gap. If you're interested in reviewing these again, I encourage you to review the presentations that'll be on our website from the sessions we have here, or just reach out to your regional team. The next myth is that pension reform is being pushed by local taxpayers. There's an article even in this morning's Detroit News that talks about the West Michigan Policy Forum and their initiative to put all public employees in 401k style plans. So our point here is just that various groups have policy objectives, that they've made it their work to influence the legislature. And that those include a shift to, for all new employees into 401k style defined benefit plans. I don't object to their right to push their policy objectives. I would say that Michigan's history of local control and the ability to meet the unique needs of each one of your municipalities is important. A one-size-fits-all system like the one that's being proposed will likely increase costs, at least in the short run, and reduce retirement security for the individuals involved. This question of retirement security is key, and I want to go into that in just a minute. I do think that the debate that we are beginning to have and that we will have misses one really important point, and that is that putting everyone in a 401k style plan, even if we do that, doesn't solve the problem that we have all identified, and that is the unfunded accrued liability needs to be managed. We'll continue to try to emphasize this with policymakers. For those of you that want to follow this issue, we do believe that there will be a push for a statewide defined contribution plan in the future. It might come this year, it might come next year. We wanted you to be informed, and we want to inform the legislature and the governor office of the impacts that such a change would mean. We also thought you might want to be informed as the debate goes along, and you may want to have your voice heard as part of that debate. So we're dedicating a portion of our website for this purpose, and we will be informing you as we go along. So if you choose to go to our website and sign up, give us your email, we'll keep you informed as this goes along. Before I end my presentation, I want to take us back to one of the key pieces of our vision, and that significantly increasing resources and awareness to help participants improve their financial wellness and be ready for retirement. Some of this will be a review for you, but so whether local plans have decided to go defined benefit or defined contribution or hybrid, MERS is addressing and trying to help the participants be ready for retirement, to take the initiative to be ready. This is the second year that we'll be delivering our snapshot reports to participants, trying to make them aware of their readiness. And we're getting really good feedback on those reports. After they see the report, they can go online and create what's called their full picture report, which allows them to put in all of their personal information. We, of course, don't have access to that information. In addition, they're easy to use action plans, so suggestions for improving your ability to be ready. And really, at the push of a button, you can change your investment selections to get you more ready for retirement. What we're looking for is to get people to take action. If you either get that yellow or that red check mark, we want you to go in, do your full picture report, take some step to move yourself toward retirement readiness. The last point I want to make is a revelation that we've had. As we were going through our strategic planning, we learned that while helping people be ready for retirement is fine and good, you really need to start a lot earlier in a person's life. The underlying concept we're talking about is financial wellness. Financial wellness is often seen as an addendum, sort of an afterthought to other benefits, but the financial health of employees should be viewed through the comprehensive lens that we do when we take care, for instance, of health care and wellness programs. The idea that wellness programs and health care make you healthier and lower your increase your longevity and lower your costs. For example, wellness programs don't just take care of employees when they're sick, but also work to prevent them from getting sick in the first place with fitness, smoking cessation, diet, and lifestyle programs. The same concept applies here. Financial wellness programs should work in the same way, offering holistic support and advice to employees so that you can meet the short-term needs while working on long-range goals. The programs have four components. And these four components are the things that we're seeing that are actually getting in the way of people being ready for retirement. Debt management, particularly for the young people that are coming out of school with college loans. Education and tools to keep them spending within one's needs. Basic budgeting skills. Education and incentives to encourage employees to become financially prepared for emergency. Having that emergency account is key to the ability to remain stable and to save for the future. Education tools and guidance to help plan for the future. The key for us now is that we can't just focus on trying to get people ready for retirement. We're going to begin moving to help people through their entire life cycle. So let me end by thanking you for listening and for the confidence that you have shown in MERS. And with that, let me introduce Jim Koss from CBIZ to talk about the actuarial update.
Thank you, Chris. As Chris said, my name is Jim Koss. I'm Senior Consulting Actuary for CBIZ Retirement Plan Services. We're the actuarial firm that's been hired by MERS to provide actuarial consulting advice. For those of you who are new to the annual conference, I want to spend a little bit of one slide talking about what an annual actuarial evaluation is, and for those who are returning members, just be a little refresher. So basically what an annual actuarial evaluation is, it's a tool to help you to manage and understand the benefit promises that your employer has made to their employees. It provides a snapshot of your plan as of December 31st every valuation year. It provides you liabilities, information on the funded level of your plan, the contributions that are required in the upcoming fiscal year for both the employers and the employees, and also provides accounting information for your comprehensive annual financial report. Many MERS municipalities have multiple divisions within their employer, and a division is simply a group of individuals who all receive the same benefit. So when we calculate contribution rates, we're actually calculating contributions for about 2,600 divisions every year. And the last point being, if you're looking at your last annual valuation, which was prepared in spring of this year, it provides the employer and employee contributions for the fiscal year that begins in 2017. So how do we calculate, how does an actuary calculate the total annual contribution? Well, we start by collecting a lot of data from MERS. We need information on the participants covered. How old are they? How much service do they have? What's their pay level? If you're a current retiree, how much are you being paid? Are you providing a portion of your retirement income to a surviving spouse? We also need to know how much assets are in the fund for every division, and also the benefits that you provide. As Chris mentioned earlier, benefit provisions are set by the local government. So each local government has the ability to set their own benefits in this, in the defined benefit plan. And we have 2,600 divisions within MERS. So we collect all this information, and we run it through basically a financial or an actuarial engine, which tries to project the likelihood of benefits being collected by participants and for how long they are made. That determines the underlying liability. We combine that information with an amortization policy and a funding policy and crank the little dial, and out comes your total annual contribution. Again, as Chris mentioned earlier, there were a number of assumption changes that occurred in the 2015 valuation. The ones having the largest impact were the assumption that individuals will be living longer than previously assumed. Well, if a person is living longer in retirement, that means more benefits are being paid out. That means that the liabilities for those benefit payments will be higher. The other major driving factor was the assumed long-term investment rate of return was decreased from 8 to 7.75. Simply put, this means that over the long term, our expectation is that MERS assets will earn 25 basis points less than we had assumed before. Well, if you're getting less investment earnings, that means that contributions will have to be higher to make up for that difference in investment earning. And then mitigating these increases somewhat is that we reduced the underlying base wage increase from 4.75% per year to 3.75% per year. MERS defined benefits are pay-related plans, and so for your active participants, we have to project out what your final average compensation will be at retirement. So the assumption that your underlying wage growth is lower means that final average compensation at retirement will be lower than expected. That lowers the expectation of the size of the benefit payments and lowers the liability somewhat. Chris also mentioned that there were several method changes. These will first be impacted in the annual valuation reports that we're going to be doing at the end of this year, December 31, 2016. One of the techniques that we use to try and limit the volatility in contributions from year to year is we use an asset smoothing method, which tries to phase in the gains and losses in the markets that occur from year to year over a period of years. We shorten that from 10 years to 5 years. And also, as Chris mentioned, newly emerging unfunded accrued liability are going to be amortized over fixed periods, and we call those layers of amortization. As I mentioned earlier, the assumption changes resulted in a lowered funded status. Liabilities increased from 2014 to 2015 as a result of this change in the assumptions. And for most municipalities, that meant that there's an increase in the annual required contribution in your 2015 valuation. Last year, the board also adopted an optional phase-in of the impact of the assumption change on your contribution. So this was in a desire to provide an option for municipalities who felt that making the jump to the higher required minimum contribution was difficult to make. So there's an optional phase-in contribution over the next 5 years. The board and the actuary definitely encourages the contribution at the full funding rate or full impact rate. The last bullet point, actual experience will ultimately determine the cost of the plan. Again, Chris mentioned earlier, these benefits are pre-funded, which means we're setting aside money now to pay for benefits in the future. We don't know how much money will actually need to be set aside until that last retirement check is written for that last retiree some point in the future. Maybe it's 70, 80 years from now. Well, at that point in time, it's not very, then you will actually know how much it cost to provide these benefits, but it's a little late in the game. So we need, that's why we need these assumptions to try and determine a reasonable pattern of contributions so that we can fund the benefits promised. A couple of graphs here just to show MERS as a group. This shows the last 60 years of MERS. Back in 1955, not too many participants and not too many municipalities in MERS. You can see, as of last year, we've got over 700 municipalities in a defined benefit plan covering over 80,000 members. This next slide shows a ratio of the active members in MERS for each pension recipient. And it might look a little alarming, but let me just take a moment to explain it. Looking on the left side of the graph, in 1955, there were 7.5 actives for every retiree collecting a benefit. And that made sense. These plans were new. You were covering active participants and nobody had really retired yet. Over time, you can see that that ratio has dropped. And in 2015, it's the first year where there was actually more retirees than there were active participants. Nothing to be alarmed about. We had been talking about this with you for years. If you remember my predecessor, Alan Sonnenstein, he said pretty much every year, a projection of this relationship will dip below one and then go back up around one over time. The reason it's dropped down is twofold. Chris mentioned MERS is bringing in new municipalities, and these municipalities are mature, meaning that there's many more, oftentimes more retirees than actives in these new municipalities that are coming in. There's also a number of municipalities that have closed all or a portion of their divisions to new membership. Well, what does that mean when you've closed your division? That means that no new active members are coming in to replace those that are retiring. So in that division, again, you're gonna have more actives or more retirees than you have actives. But as I mentioned, if we project this out over time, I'd expect that ratio to be around one. This graph shows a distribution of the funded percentage. Again, each municipality is valued on its own based on its own data, benefit provisions, and funded status. So you'd expect to see a distribution of funded statuses by the municipalities. This next graph shows a distribution of employer contribution rates by division. The salmon colored bars are the 2015 results and the blue ones are for the previous valuation year. Again, there's a pretty wide distribution because the contributions vary between the divisions based on the benefit provisions provided by the local municipality. Now a word about the annual evaluation results. Can't emphasize enough that every MERS employer stands on its own. So when you're talking with the folks around the table and you're comparing things, you got to remember that it's highly likely you're providing different benefits to different, perhaps, populations of individuals at different points in their career. So very difficult to say Muni A and Muni B, let's compare the two. For most employers, the 2015 actuarial annual evaluation results will show an increase in the contribution level from the prior year based on the full impact rates. As I mentioned before, the primary driver of this increase is due to the assumption changes. We're also facing increases because we're still factoring in losses that occurred in the asset market in prior years. MERS amortization policy is one to provide funding as a fixed percent of payroll. And so as your payroll is assumed to increase, the contribution as a percentage of that payroll may remain stable, but the dollar value of the contribution will increase. So we'll see some increases in contribution just as a result of the funding policy. Again, each of these municipalities is different, and so there may be increases or decreases in the contribution due to what actually happened to your demographics. Did more people retire than expected? Were pay raises higher or lower than expected? That has an impact on your results as well. And finally, what does the future hold? I just want to reiterate that MERS does remain in a strong financial position overall. Most municipalities have assets on hand equal to many times next year's annual benefit payout. Dollar contributions are expected to continue to increase, both as a function of the level percent of payroll method, and also if your municipality elects to use the phase-in of the contribution increase from, so don't pay the full impact contribution rate. If you go down that path, the rate of increase in your contributions will be steeper than if you just stuck to the full impact. Because we had losses in previous years that are still working their way through the system, this is going to require a better than 7.75% assumed rate of return in the future to avoid additional increases in the contribution rate. Finally, a couple of points about your specific division. Smaller divisions are going to have a bigger, have more risk of volatility in contribution rates than a larger one. And that just makes sense because if you've got a small division that only has five participants and somebody retires or dies, that has a big impact on that five-person group. If that same person retires or dies in a group of 100, that has less of an impact for that size group. So sort of hopefully that makes sense. Very mature divisions, that means a division with many more retirees than active participants. You could see your funded ratio decline before it starts to work its way back up to 100% under our funding policy. And that's just a function of benefits being paid out exceeding the contributions that are coming in for the year. So it's a cash flow issue. And then we talk about maturity again. MERS has been around for 70 years. When MERS first started, there were no retirees, there were just actives. Well, as people worked their way through their career, assets were invested, people earned benefits, and now we're paying out the benefits. We're in the distribution phase of a defined benefit plan. Nothing to be alarmed about. That's the whole point of pre-funding these plans. We're setting aside assets to pay for these benefits. And with that, I think you'll now hear an investment update from MERS Chief Investment Officer, Jeb Burns. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Jeb Burns, Chief Investment Officer, and I always feel, after following the actuary, as if I've done something bad and I have to go to the principal's office. And maybe I'm just hypersensitive, I don't know. So what I'm gonna talk to you today a little bit about is give you an overview of the market and the global economic situation that we're functioning in, talk about fund performance, and then a little bit about the Office of Investments, kind of how we are structured in governance, and then kind of future trends that you should expect to see from the investment management program. Okay. I think nobody would be surprised that the economy is slowing a little bit. We're 8 years into a moderate recovery from the global financial crisis, so it's not expected. We're not in recessionary territory yet, but it's prudent to, reduce risk, as the business cycle stretches out. So growth is vulnerable to shocks, and one of the takeaways I think from my talk today is just to expect more volatility. It's natural at this point in the cycle, and GDP growth is slowing down. Year on year, you see the bottom bullet point, we're at 1.2%, so still positive, but slowing. And the chart on the left side, you can see that shows the index of leading indicators, and we've been in positive territory for quite a while, and it's trending down. So, this is just one of the things we monitor, and it kind of lets us know, when we should kind of elevate risk in the portfolio and when we should kind of go back to, kind of a policy weighting, which is kind of where we're sitting right now. Risks are not just market risks, but they're also geopolitical risks. The U.S. is the only world superpower, and we are retreating from some of our foreign entanglements, and regionalism is rising. And what that means, in kind of simple terms, is there are more dangerous neighborhoods and more volatility and greater risks to political and policy mistakes. So tensions are rising between the U.S., China, and Russia. Emerging markets, which reformed themselves greatly after the Asian debt crisis in 1998, they're piling on more debt, and there have been excesses in their systems, so they are vulnerable to political shocks. And the developed markets, I mean, if we look at this election cycle in the U.S. just as an example, you had the rise of Bernie Sanders and then Donald Trump. That tells you that their voters are generally unhappy. You had the vote, Brexit for England to leave the European Union. That just creates more noise in the marketplace. So we monitor that. So we know that after Brexit, the markets went down for 4 days, then they went back up. So you should expect to see more upward and downward movement in the portfolio. And that's just kind of a factor of the world that we live in today. When I speak of market volatility, this is, I hate to say this, but this is one of my favorite slides, but it kind of illustrates what we do. And if you look at that blue line at the bottom, that's the VIX, which is really the fear index. And it kind of talks about, are markets, exuberant or are they fearful? And then that black line is the S&P 500. And you can see there's almost a complete inverse movement to those. And you see the September 11 attacks, the VIX spikes, the S&P goes down. The Lehman collapse, the same thing, and it goes all the way out. You see small movements in the recent Brexit vote. As an institutional disciplined investor, we need to keep this right on the forefront of our decision-making processes. When risk goes up, we should invest more in the market, and we should, take risk down when you see the market's at an all-time high. So that's one of the benefits of having an institutional team in place, is that we know that this kind of volatility exists, and we structure the portfolio to take advantage of it over an extended period of time. Love this slide. This is not here to demonstrate that the Fed chairman have gotten smaller over time, but they have. But I'm gonna spend the next couple slides talking. It is kind of funny, they actually have. That's their real heights. They've gotten smaller since Volcker and in the 70s and 80s, but this is to demonstrate that really since 1979, interest rates have steadily come down. It took a while, I think, for the markets and all of us as individuals to really internalize that, but that's been the case, and interest rates do impact the returns you can expect from any portfolio. That is just, it's a mathematical fact. So this chart shows the dark blue is MERS rolling 10 years, returns since 19, I'm old now, so I think it's 75. And any point in time shows the annualized return for the 10 years in the past. And the lighter blue line is the 10-year bond, which you could expect from investing in fixed income markets. And what this shows, if you go back to the peak, which is around 1980, you could expect in a bond portfolio to earn about 15%. The MERS portfolio over the trailing 10 years, it earned 14%. What you've seen is that diversified portfolio return has come down as interest rates have come down. It's not a bad thing, it's a reflection of the market environment and as it's changed over time. We are in historic times though. Global government bond yields they're at historic lows. You see, over a third of the world bonds trades with negative yields. I was actually in an office of our custodial bank when they literally were preparing a letter to send to their corporate clients in Europe that they were going to now charge them to keep cash in the bank. That's, in any of our lives, that's odd. You expect if you put your money in a bank that you're gonna get paid interest, but the fact now is in some places you're actually charged to keep your money there. Less than 10% of the bonds yield over 2%, and that's globally. So we are in historic times. The takeaway from this is, as investors and as people, we always think the good times will go on forever and the bad times will never end. The fact that we are at historic lows tells you that we're in the bottoming process. So at some point in the future, rates will go up. Now, if that is at next year or 3 years from now, I don't know, but at this point, if you're a betting person, at some point they have to go up because they are at historic lows. This slide, which many of you have seen, was recently in the Wall Street Journal, is produced by Cowen Associates, a global institutional consultant in the investment area. And what this shows, and this really demonstrates the issue that we all have with managing portfolios in our personal or institutional life. In 1995, 100% bonds, core bonds, safe bonds, you'd get 7.75% at low risk, at 6% risk levels. 10 years later, you got to add quite a bit of equity exposure, stocks, even some real estate, and even some private equities, and you're going to get that same 7.5% number, but your risk has gone up about 40% to 8.9%. Fast forward a decade to where we are today. You need to add some, a little more international, some emerging market equities, a few more alternatives to get to that same 7.5 number, but with dramatically increased risk. And that is largely simply a factor of the fact that interest rates have come down so low. And won't stay this way forever, but that's the environment that we're functioning in right now. One thing I think that hasn't changed, even though we have had to take on additional risk, is the portfolio that we try to build is specifically designed to provide some downside protection. So when the stock markets are down, 50, 60% as they were in 2008, the MERS portfolio will not be down even close to that. We, in a dramatic pullback, we will be down, but not nearly as much as the equity markets. And that diamond in the middle is the policy benchmark. So if you invested just in global stocks and bonds in indexes, that's the return and the risk level you would expect to receive. And you can see MERS is up to the left and above that. So over time, we've been able to earn higher returns at lower risk. And just as an example, you see the light blue dot up in the upper right. That's the stock market, proxy for the stock market. Higher returns, but much higher risk. And then every now and then, when markets get tough, people will say, we'll even say it ourselves, why don't we just all put it in bonds or cash? Well, if you go down to that green dot in the left, that shows that's what you're going to expect from a 30-day T-bill. That's cash. And that's not close to your actual rate of assumption, but very low risk. The mix of all those assets allow us to get a higher returning, lower volatility, lower risk portfolio that over multiple decades has added value, and I'll show that in a moment. So approved yesterday at the board meeting, this is the new asset allocation chart, which I can think on my feet, so I can fill this in for you. So the dark blue, the biggest chunk at 55.5% is equities. So that hasn't changed much. It's gone down like a percent from the one 3 years ago. If you go up and you see the light, the very lightest color, that's diversifying strategies. That's gone up 2%. So that would be private credit, hedge fund-like investments, things that are not correlated either to stocks or bonds. What we're hoping there is that when the stock market falls, they won't fall that much. So we're targeting a return kind of between stocks and bonds. Then you see that 13.5%, that's real assets. And that's gone up a percentage or two. And that's where your real estate is, that's where your farmland is, timber and croplands, things like that. And then the bottom one, the 18.5% is, those are bonds. We lowered that 1%. And that's really about as low a level as we're comfortable doing. Because at the end of the day, even in a low interest rate environment, bonds provide that buffer, that downside protection. They reduce the overall volatility of the portfolio. And then frankly, we are in the business of making sure that we can meet our pension obligations. As Chris said, we've never missed a pension payment, and I can tell you right now, I'm never going to tell Chris that we don't have money to send our pensioners. That would be a pension crisis for the CIO. Okay, we're going to talk about total market fund performance. What you see up there right now is that is our performance over multiple time periods, and again, you can see that 35-year mark, we're at 9.43%. I would also highlight the seven-year mark. We're over 9% there, and that's really bottoming out in 2008. We've had strong equity returns during that time period. Now, you know, not hitting the assumption rate in the at the 5 and the 3 year mark, but over an extended period, we probably will get there. So this shows the policy benchmark. And what this means is over every time period, we've added value. So the active decisions, the active asset allocation that the board approved and the decisions that my team make have added value. So they've added incremental returns. So you are better off for the decisions the board made than you would have been in a passive index. And that chart is, that's the stock market returns for the same period, higher, and you would expect that, higher returns in equities, but greater volatility. And then this last one is bonds. And again, lower returns than the diversified MERS portfolio, and but with less volatility, a little more safety. Some good news. It's been a pretty good year. So as of 8/31, the end of August, we're at 8.1% year to date, and we're outperforming our policy benchmark by 0.69%. So very strong upward market performance, not normally expected. That's a result of the asset allocation decisions we've made are really adding value. Our small cap bias, our exposure to emerging markets, and the equity and debt side have really helped this year. In addition to that, the active managers are all doing quite well in the portfolio. So normally you would expect the portfolio to lag the benchmark a little bit, but sometimes everything kind of works out perfectly. And year to date, since August, returns are similar. They're up a little bit. We're about 8.4, 8.5 right now. So it's a presidential year. Normally that tends to be pretty good. So we'd like to close the books today, but hopefully things will continue as the rest of the year goes on. So I show this slide every year. So this goes back to 1975, and it's like if you gave MERS $10,000 and left it and let it experience the return stream, the returns that we have, how would you do versus the actuarial rate of assumption, which historically was 8 and now 7.75? And what this shows is the compounding of that is you would be better off being in a diversified portfolio managed by MERS, even with the ups and downs. Because the ups, again, have been better than the actual rate of assumption. So it's a good slide, and it reinforces that over extended periods of time, being in an institutionally managed portfolio has worked and benefited all of us. It's not just myself. My team might think sometimes that I think it's just myself, but it's not. There's a 9-member team. With over 200 years of experience collectively, and you're going to get a chance to meet many of them in a few moments. They've got pension administration experience, business administration experience, commercial banking, commercial real estate. It's a robust, deep, complementary team of people. And I think that's what's needed to actually navigate the complicated world that we're in today, particularly from an investment management perspective. And they have numerous advanced degrees and certifications. You can see here we've got people with MBAs, law degrees, multiple CFA charter holders, which is the highest designation in the investment management field, as well as economics, actuarial science, and that political history person. They let him talk every now and then. That's about all they let him do. Governance is critical. Many people have said, it's like if you write it down, it will happen. Process is key to what we do. Process is key to everything because it keeps you on point. It keeps you, when times get tough or emotions get high, you're able to execute on your long-term plan. And this chart shows, again, the board is the ultimate fiduciary. They approve the risk levels that we can take in the portfolio, and they approve the asset allocation, every 3 years. Then you have a subset of the board, the investment committee, which is made up of outside investors and the chair of the board. And they really serve as kind of the policymaking board and really kind of a fact-checking part for the board because they have industry experience and they provide value add and ideas to us. But, they can also communicate, confidence or concerns directly to the board about the actions that the investment office is taking. We've created an investment management risk and compliance committee. This is made up of the CEO, CFO, internal auditor, and legal counsel. We get together on a quarterly basis to talk about investment-related risk, either from the portfolio or from the regulatory environment, that we really feel that could impact the enterprise, so that we're making adjustments from a compliance standpoint if we have to early, and that we're all on the same page. And it's, I think it's really facilitated sharing between the different regulatory entities within MERS. And then there's my portfolio review committee, and this is my senior officers, and we get together when we're going to make changes to the portfolio. We'll conduct research, we'll have vigorous debate, we will then vote on taking an action formally, and we'll record those votes, and then if successful, then we take that to the investment committee. So there's multiple layers of deliberation taking place. We're nimble, so I don't want you to think it's bureaucratic. I think it's prudent, and it's best practice, multiple layers of governance, and I think it serves us very well. And then again, you've got the Office of Investments and the broader team managing a $9.5 billion portfolio. There's the investment side, but then there's the compliance, there's the governance, there's managing 50 plus relationships and vendors. That is a business unto itself, and it's very complex. And having people there with 20 plus years experience in that sector is critical. And I think we do a pretty good job of managing the operational and governance components of the plan. So, okay, in summary, it's a challenging investment environment. The lower interest rates, they will likely not be here forever, but they do put some stress on the investment program, and risks, both at the political and the market, from a market perspective, are elevated. And my job is to monitor those and to be act comfortably when that happens. But that you just need to know that we've had strong long-term performance and risk controls in place. There's an experienced and effective investment management team. Some trends that you should expect. One of the things that we can control are fees. We're hard negotiators, and those savings get passed directly on to you. So we're going to be bringing more investments in-house. We manage currently 25% of them with my team, and aside from our salaries, there's no expense to the fund. And we've been able to actually outperform the market. So you could expect more of that, and we'll seek other areas to lower our costs. And just if there's one takeaway, understand that we have a strong governance and oversight in place. And I talk to my peers around the country, and MERS, I am very lucky to work for MERS. I mean, I get to be a fiduciary, but our governance structure from the board level all the way down is functional. It is not dysfunctional. And so so we can make good decisions, we can react to difficult times, and it's a wonderful place to work, and thank you so much for your time today. And actually, just stick around for a little bit, because we're gonna have an investment fireside chat, and you can actually hear a little bit more from members of my team.
All right, thank you, Jeb. As well, thank you, Jim and Chris. And would you join me in one more round of applause for Jeb, Jim, and Chris? All right, we're coming to the home stretch of the business portion of the meeting. There are a couple last items. One is I did not receive any resolutions prior to the annual conference. As such, I would declare the floor open for any type of discussion or questions that the membership might have. The floor is open. If you have a question you'd like to ask, please feel free to step to one of the microphones. I'll ask any, make sure somebody's not moving and intending to. All right. Pardon me. Hearing none, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn the 70th annual business meeting of the Municipal Employees Retirement System. Could I get somebody to make a motion? Would you speak your name and Ms. Karen Folks from Cass County has made a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second? I have a second. Can you tell us your name and municipality? Pam, I didn't hear it. I'm sorry, I didn't. Can you speak up? Tyrese from Detroit, Wayne County. Thank you. So we have a motion and a second to adjourn the 70th annual business meeting. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Any opposed? Wonderful. Thank you. We're adjourned.